Hello all. In one of my last video, Merlin video, I got called out for messing with all those batteries and not having a decent bench power supply. And I said, you know, you're right. I should have one. But I got this instead. I really don't know much about it, but it had everything I was looking for, so I'll reserve judgment. It's a Mastech HY3005F, 3005F-3 triple power supply, two adjustable supplies there that you can run independently of one another, or in series, or in parallel. And they're supposed to track one another, so you can have positive, negative rails out of it. And this this one dedicated 5-volt output at 3 amps fixed, right? So this just arrived. I haven't even powered it up yet, and thought let's take a look at it. It's a big hulking beast. It's a linear supply, right? So it's not a lightweight. It weighs about 25 pounds or so. And, oops, I don't know what that was. Look at the size of the heat sinks on the back of that thing. They're monstrous. And there's an AC input. It looks like a little fuse. I think there's a fuse in there, it looks like that opens up, but input voltage, and it talks about a fuse, QC passed, made in China, as you would expect from anything you buy like this these days. Quite a bit less money than the BK Precision supply I had my eye on, and I was gonna peel that off, but I can't. Maybe it's not supposed to come off. It looks like it wants to come off. Anyway, needed something for the bench. The viewer that called me on it, rightfully so. This is something I've been neglecting doing for my bench for a while now, just using cobbled together junk and home built contraptions when I needed them, and I should stop wasting so much time with that stuff and just get down to business here. So we have our current and voltage pots. They're just single turn pots, and there's no coarse or fine adjustment, so we will have to see just how usable it is. Amp volt display. This side on the right is designated master. Slave on that side. Something about that bothers me. I would rather see the master on the left and the slave on the right, but I can live with that. Switches to make them independent of one another, series, parallel. I really need to read the manual to learn how that works. And speaking of manual, it did, in fact, come with user's manual. So, and they show, interesting, they show on the cover like an LCD equipped model and an analog equipped model, but this one has supposed to have 7-segment red and green LED displays in it. So I'm going to take a look through this manual. The manual is gives a bunch of specs. It's supposed to give, let's see, constant voltage within 0.01%. It's 2 millivolts. constant current or short circuit protection. 1% accuracy on the display. Fixed output 5 volts plus or minus 2.5%. Wow. Yes. And ripple and noise 0.5 millivolts per 0.5 millivolts RMS. Minus 40 plus or minus 40 degrees C. Oh, no, I'm sorry, 0 to plus 40 degrees C, 90% humidity. That's good. So let's see. Very stable, regulated, multiple output DC power supplies, allowing continuous adjustment of both the output voltage and current levels. The HY3000, I'm looking, well, let's see, the none of those model numbers listed there for, let's see, it says the XYZ2 series have dual LED displays and dual analog displays for that one, and the 4 LED 2 color display. Well, none of the model numbers that it's talked about so far are the one I have. Oh, there it is, the HY3005-F-3, and it is 0 to 30 volts on either one of the variable supplies, 0 to 5 amps on either one of the variable supplies, and fixed 5 volts at 3 amps on the third one. And there's a diagram of the knobs and so forth, and manual's not bad. It came with one. That's saying something. Let's see. Just okay. Dual power supply. Used in series mode, select switch 14 to the in positions and switch 13 to the out position. Adjust control 6 and 8 clockwise to the maximum position. Adjust control 5. Okay, well, we'll just have to play around with that thing. And just instructions on how to set up the dual tracking stuff and then some blank pages. Okay. And it came with a nice chunky power cord, one of those big heavy cord here. I cannot read that. 18, or is it 16? No, it's definitely 18 gauge. It feels nice, and this, like I said, this thing is really heavy. It's got a good rubber strap on the top of it, and this protective film, which doesn't seem to want to come off. So let's take a look inside this thing. Okay, well, not off to a good start. I got one screw out fine. This screw just didn't feel right, but I kept going anyway, and it just twisted off and broke right in the middle. So now there's part of a screw stuck in that hole. And I've got 6 more or so screws to go. Wish me luck. Okay, let's have a look inside here. Just lifts off and pretty clean inside of there. All wires are dry. some loose knocking around wires, little stuff. Big ones are tied down, tied together. And let's see, got a bunch of relays there, big honking rectifiers there, bunch of power resistor stuff, big filter cap. What's on those heat sinks in the back? That can't see them from this side. There's something on the back side of these boards that's attached to these heat sinks. Oh, right here. There's a protective cover over those heat sinks. There's something underneath there. I can take these covers off and look underneath them. It's a big, I'm gonna guess that's a big what is that? D1047, man, it's a big rectifier or something. And on this side we've got, well, this side looks exactly the same as the other side. It's just a mirror image of that board over there. This would be the other channel for the other variable power supply, okay. And giant transformer bolted down securely. There is a lock washer and a flat washer and this big metal plate just holding this big donut transformer down to the bottom. The case is steel. It's steel all around except for the front bezel. It's got these braces here making everything nice and solid. And this down here, let's see, it's connected to that guy, and from the transformer, and looks like it runs to the 5-volt output. Okay, so that must be a giant 5-volt regulator. This is the board that drives it. I'll try to get a look at what that chip is there. It's a little ST chip of some kind. I'll have to look that one up later. But, yeah, it appears that board just takes care of the dedicated 5-volt output on the front. And there's our dual channels, big transformer, big linear regulators. Let's see what's going on under these. Aha! Pretty old school stuff there, but you know, it still works. 2N3055. Three of those. Imagine there's three more just like it under that side. And those are my big linear regulators for, well, they're transistors acting as voltage regulators for, you know, the output transistors for the variable supplies. One side and then the other. Well, that's not bad inside. I don't see anything initially that makes me say, wait a minute, what is that? That doesn't look safe, but it actually does look like it's dressed out pretty well, and everything is single-sided boards. Everything's silk screened pretty nicely. Looks like that the little board down there has a rectifier on the bottom that's screwed down to the case, and what kind of caps did they use here? Can't get in there. Can't read what kind of capacitors they're using down there. That is ones at the top. Can't read them. Can't read them out there either. They're all tied down and turned to the inside, so you can't see what kind of caps they are. So give it a little board for the power button up in the front here. Big mechanical power button, and it's just held in with plastic standoffs, but doesn't feel spongy or anything. Seems to work. I wanted to look at this. So we get into that fuse holder. Apparently we can't. Alright, so let's close it back up. And there's some chips in here to look at. Let me take you off of the tripod here. Alright, that is a LM3 turn you upside down. LM324. And I'll bet that's what that is down in the bottom as well. Let's see. LM3. No, LM7236, is that right? LM7236 or so. Don't know what that is. But I'm sure this is for a couple little chips here. What do we got there? Get off of there. That is another ST. All the chips are ST. In here, a 741. And another 741. Components there. What is that? Can't read that. Oh, it's 7812 right there, and a D313. Not sure what that is. I'm sure it's another regulator of some sort, but anyway, a couple of trimmers there that we're not going to mess with today. And SNE brand capacitors. Alright, well, that's the insides of it. It looks reasonably well constructed. Did we see the back of the panel, the front panel board there? Just some caps stuck through the back side. A couple of connections. And some 7-segment displays in there. Alright, so let's put it back together, power it up, and start testing this thing. Boy, this is a kind of a pain to get hold of. Alright, there we go. Lost it. There it is. Okay. Mains power in. And let's just turn everything down. Independent. Power on. Wow, the lights dim in the house when it fires up. Ooh, that is nice. That display is really quite nice. I can see that across the room. All right, so let's just turn some knobs. Nothing happens there because I've got the currents turned all the way down. Let's fool with the master. Oh, interesting. With current all the way turned down, 0.4 volts, you turn it up a little and it drops to zero. All right, well, it doesn't indicate. Now I see my indicator go from constant current to constant voltage. I am kind of disappointed that turning the current up does not show me what the current is set to. So I can't dial in 100 milliamps and then switch the power on. I've got to, let's see, let's set this to 3 volts and we'll dial the current down. See it go to constant current and the voltage drops out. But it does not show me what the current is set to. I have no idea. That is kind of disappointing. But better than what I was using, which was nothing. Now let's see. That is kind of funky there. If you've got a banana plug like this, you can't plug it in to this this jack. You can fit it in the 5 volt jack there. The old crusty 87 for this one. Right. Old crusty 87 says 4.29 volts. See it a little better. 4.29 volts. Let's dial this up. Oh, it's in current limit mode, so let's dial that up a bit. Okay, now let's go up to 2.0. The knob is touchy, as you would expect, because there's no fine control, but it's not too bad. You being that you're only looking at a tenth of a volt here, it's, you know, can't do much about that. But trying to dial it in with the meter to, let's say, 2.50, 2.58, 2.4, yeah, it's a little fussy. 255. If you're not too picky about your voltages, it's fine for that. Let's go up to 5. You can hear it click into the next range. 5, 4.9, 5, 5, 4.96, it says 5.1. So it tracks reasonably well. Probably good enough for the the kind of work I do in here, just playing around. 12 volts, up to 12. Let's try 10. Stop at 10. 10.1. Yeah. 11, 12.0, 12.03. Yeah, not bad. 15. And current blammo, it just drops it. Okay. So what we need is to put a load on this thing. By the way, I forgot to test the fixed 5 volt supply. So let's hook that up. 5.01. That'll do nicely. Okay, I've arranged a little test here of the current limiting capability. I've got a little Dave Jones dummy load, electronic load here that I knocked together, and the way I was complaining earlier about, well, you know, without a load connected you can't see what your current limiter is set to, and well, the way you set it up is you turn the current all the way down. That's one thing that's kind of funny about this. If you turn the current knob all the way down, it's permanently locked into constant current mode until you rock it back clockwise just a little bit. Until your voltage shows up again. Otherwise, it's just permanently shut off. Okay, so you take your positive lead and you short it out, right? Now with it shorted, your voltage drops to zero, but you can adjust your current. Let's say we want 250 milliamps. So now that that is set, we can unplug that. We can dial our voltage in to what we want it to be. Let's say we want 10 volts. Okay. And then we'll hook our dummy load back up. Alright, now I've got my meter over here, the Fluke, monitoring the voltage dropped across the resistors in the dummy load. I'm sure you've all seen that Dave Jones video. That device is really cool, so I went ahead and built one. And that's how we know what the load is really set to. And we'll just compare the current being drawn from the supply against that, and at what point it cuts off. They should match up. Alright, so we'll start bringing up our load here. Alright, there's 6, and they're tracking reasonably well together. 120 milliamps, yeah. Coming up on 200. 196, 197, 200, yeah, they're pretty much in step with one another. Alright, coming up on the 250 milliamp cutoff point that I set. And it dropped out. Okay. 246 millivolts there. And it's cut off. So back the load back down. I'll turn that knob up some arbitrary value. I'm not going to bother. That's the wrong attitude. I'll disconnect the load and short it back out. Having trouble doing that. 2 amps? Yeah, why not? And put the load back up. Okay, and then we'll bring our, I don't think I want to pull 2 amps at 10 volts through my load here. It's not tested for that capacity. I did just piece it together out of junk after all, so no particular attention paid to what the component values were. Alright, here we go. Let's wind it up to 1 amp. Thereabouts. 9.4, 9.6. Yeah, starting to drift a little bit. Still really close. Close enough. 36, 134. Of course, it's a 20-year-old meter too. That's probably never seen the business end of a cal lab. So I'm not too worried about it. Not for the fooling around that I do. Okay, we just dropped out. .96. Yeah, that's right. 2 amps through the load. The heat sink is staying nice and cool. That's good. And we'll wind our load back down again. Jumps back up. Limit. There we go. Good deal. So let's look at the DC ripple. Here's my electronic load I cobbled together. It's pulling about a quarter amp at 5 volts right now, and that ringing right there is actually from this dummy load, the comparator. I used an LM393 instead of an op amp because that's what I had, and it does the job, but it induces that ringing noise because it switches just on and off, on and off, on and off. But the flat area in between is what I'm interested in. That's going to be the DC in between the rings, and I can turn this all the way down to 20 millivolts per division and not see a great deal of noise there. Now, it's a linear supply, so sure, we're not going to see a lot. It's pretty interesting that I can turn my dummy load here. I can start to turn it up. No, down. Turn it up. And as I'm turning it up, I can watch that ringing calm down. I'm about a half amp now. And just watch it go away. Now I'm about 3/4 of an amp. About 800 milliamps. And it reduces it down to a little spike like that. Very little. Noise in between, and you just gotta ignore the big stuff. We're looking for trash on those peaks, and I don't see any. Okay, I've reconfigured. We're using the Fluke as an ammeter now, and instead of reading the voltage across the dummy load, it's actually measuring the current. And just run that up and down a little bit. 47, 5, 9, 6, and 6, yeah. 9, 8. One, yeah. Just about dead on. Good enough, anyway. Very nice. So one of the things this machine will let you do is join the two variable supplies in series or parallel with each other. So I'll show you that. Power it up. Select a, let's just say 3.5 volts on this side. See, this one is at 5.3. Let's set the current limiting up by shorting that out. Set current limit to 300 milliamps. And we'll do the same on the slave supply. Short it out, set 300 milliamps. Touchy. There we go. 300 milliamps. And then we will join them in series with this button. Click series. Now you saw that drop down to 3.5 volts to match the one that the master, match the level the master is set. Then positive from the master and negative from the slave. Hook those up to our meter and we get 7 volts, 6.96 volts, 7 volts, the two of them joined together in series just like a battery. And if we wind that up, wind up the master side to 8 volts, you see the slave supply go with it. Wherever this right side goes, the left side goes with it, and you get the sum of the two of them on your output. So we can go all the way up by just turning this one knob. We can go all the way up to 30, almost 31 volts on each supply, and we get nearly 62 on this side. The reason I set the current limiting before we got started here, set the current limit independent, is because the current limiting does not track between these two. You've got to set it in both sides. So if the current limiter kicks in on the master, but the current limiter on the slave side is turned up to max, that one will just keep constant voltage output and will not current limit. So be careful of that. Set them both up before you hook them up in series. So I just said something that doesn't quite sit right with me, and I had to check this out. The manual for this thing says, it warns that the current limiting does not track when these two channels are run in series. So if you've got this limited on the master side, but the slave is wide open, it won't clamp, it won't crowbar, it won't cut off at the same level as does this one. But it seems to me, here's what bothers me about that: if the voltage is tracking and it goes into constant current mode, it's going to start reducing your voltage as the current draw comes out more. So if the slave is tracking the master's voltage, shouldn't it also start to pull down? So I don't know. Let's set it up. I've got a series I've got them wired in series here, so 1 volt on either supply, 2 volts output through the dummy load here. I'm just going to wind it up. I've got, I had preset the current limiter at 100 milliamps, or 150 milliamps rather, on the master, but this one is all the way open. So let's just see what happens. Let's turn our load up and start pulling it down. Okay, we're almost there. Okay, now I can see. Oh yeah, that works. What are they talking about? So I hit 150 milliamps. And the voltage, you can see the voltage drop out. When the master flip into constant current mode. Voltage drops out. The slave channel follows it down. All right, I'm going to keep going up on the load, and it doesn't change. 150 milliamps. Voltage on the fluke there, 0.167. So I'm not sure what they're talking about. That seems to do just fine. It did exactly what, when you think about it, you should expect it to do. The slave channel did, in fact, track the voltage dropout of the master when the current limiter kicked in. And there's the draw, 150 milliamps from both sides. So forget what I said before. Maybe it's not the way in print that they literally meant, but it does seem to work just fine. They also recommend that you put a jumper, a heavy gauge wire between these two terminals, between the positive of the slave, negative of the master. Link those two together externally right here with some heavy gauge wire. The switch does join them internally, as you see, but if you're pulling 5 amps, well, I guess the switch isn't rated for that internally, so jumper link on the outside when doing this. So the one thing I haven't tested yet is I haven't tried to assert its claim of 5 amps on each channel, so let's see if we can do that. I've got the little dummy load hooked up here. The slave channel, they're running independent now, but this left side is just providing power to the circuitry on the dummy load. The other side is going to be our current source, and we have it plumbed through the multimeter, through the ammeter, and into the dummy load back to ground there. So we'll start cranking up the dummy load and watch our current to go. Here it comes, climbing up through milliamps and a half amp, and up 1, 2, clamp set, yeah, current limiting kicks in at 5 amps, and the fluke meter agrees with that, and I'm going to turn it down because I don't know that my dummy load can survive that for very long. It's not too warm, but I don't know how long it would live if I left it that way, but okay, it does deliver on its promise of 5 amps. The fluke, old crusty there, backs it up. So okay, well done. I think it's a pretty solid little unit. I like the way it's constructed. It's missing some of the nicer features that a more costly device would have, like a fine controls for current and voltage. But it's not bad, especially for the things I do that just aren't that precise, really. It's gonna treat me well, I think. The accuracy of the onboard readout seems to be adequate, and the construction inside was very nice. Everything was dressed and secured out of the way, and I didn't see anything, I didn't see any bodge wires on it. Of course, I filmed that late last night, so I could have forgotten, but I didn't see anything that looked dicey in there at all. It seems to be well constructed and seems to deliver on all of the specs. So I'm gonna welcome it into my home as a permanent part of my bench. Anyway, I hope you find that helpful, and if you like that mess, give me a thumbs up, and I will talk at you soon. Thanks.